You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
California. My name is Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And this is The Garden Show, which is a live broadcast where we talk about everything about gardens. I like to say from trees to turf and apples to zinnias, which means if it grows in the ground or in a pot, and if it's green, we talk about it. So, just getting ready here to start our lecture. If you haven't watched the show before, I'm a plant pathologist and a certified arborist and a pest control advisor. I've been working in the industry for many, many years, and you can give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 and ask any question you want about your garden, about plant material you've got in your garden, about anything you're interested in. Some plants that you want to grow, if you want to know they'll do well. Where should you grow them in your garden? How much sun should they get? How much should you water them? How do you prune them? How do you fertilize them? How do you control their pests? We talk about all of that on this program. We like to start our show with upcoming events, and we'll do that momentarily. But just to let you know, today's lecture will be on oaks. We'll cover all or most of the native oaks, and then we'll talk about some non-native oaks, which are commonly grown in Southern California. And we also have a mystery plant. So let's go ahead and go to our upcoming events, so you can put this on your calendar. And we've had some wonderful spring weather the last couple weeks, and not too hot, although we had some real hot spells there a little while ago. The weather's been wonderful, so get out and enjoy our wonderful Southern California weather and learn something about plants at these upcoming events. Let's take a look, see what we've got. We've got the Rose Show in sale. The Pacific Rose Society will present varieties, and you can be able to purchase some as well. This will be in Ayers Hall at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on North Baldwin in Arcadia on April 25th from 11 to 4:30 in the afternoon, and you can give them a call at 626-821-4623. Of course, the rose shows will be just absolutely spectacular. There'll be hundreds of blooms. It'll knock your socks off. Going to flower shows is so much fun because in one room you'll see dozens if not hundreds of varieties for that particular plant material, in this case, roses. And roses are by far the most popular ornamental plant grown in gardens around the world. In addition to that, we have the Art Workshop. This will be in the Oak Room at the LA County Arboretum on April 20th from 9:30 to 11:30. This is a workshop that provides a supportive environment for those who wish to do art. And it'll probably be art, of course, associated with the gardens, so there's a lot of opportunity to do art in gardens, whether you're painting landscapes or photographing landscapes or maybe making things out of some of the materials you can collect in a garden. And we have, in addition to the art workshop, we have our last upcoming event, the Crescent Farm Workshop, which will also be at the Arboretum on April 23rd from 10 to 4. And you will look at new and old horticultural techniques for growing materials in your garden, particularly edible plant materials. So give them a call at 626-821-4623 for more information about that. And of course, if you want to get out and learn something about plants, there are several really excellent botanical gardens, and most of you are probably familiar with them. Descanso Gardens in La Cañada, the Huntington Gardens, of course, it's the Huntington Library, Art Galleries, and Botanical Gardens in San Marino, the Arboretum in Arcadia, the Fullerton Arboretum, the San Diego Botanical Gardens. All of these institutions have classes that teach homeowners and garden enthusiasts more about growing plant materials, widen your plant palette, learn more about various plant materials. And of course, Rancho Santa Ana, I don't want to slight anyone, Rancho Santa Ana out in Claremont, especially if you're interested in native plants, they are the leader in growing and preserving our California heritage of native plants. And they can be a little hard to grow, to tell you the truth, for a variety of reasons. There are some challenges in growing natives, but once you get them established and they're doing well, then it should be, you should do pretty good. But we'll can talk more about the challenges of growing native plants. Our mystery plant today is right here. You won't be able to see this well unless you go to the overhead, so let's go to the overhead to take a look at it. If you recognize the plant, if you know the common name, and it goes by several different common names, and this is a little 4-inch pot of individual plants. These aren't really a clump. And so they really just have two leaves here, and they, I'll tell you where they're native to. They're native to Africa. I'm not going to tell you what part of Africa, or Africa is a very large continent. And there's plants from all over Africa. These come from Africa, certain areas of Africa, of course. So if you recognize what this is, I'll give you a clue that it is in the ice plant family, which is called the Mesembranthaceae or the Azoaceae. The Mesembranthaceae is the old name. If you have an idea what that is, give us a call and take a guess. Either give us a genus name, because I doubt if you could identify that to species just over the TV screen, unless you know them quite well. And today we're going to talk about oaks. We're going to talk about some of the real threats to oaks in California. We've got some real serious pests of oaks that are doing quite a bit of damage. In some areas, we're losing a lot of oaks. That's really kind of frightening if you're a plant person. And I just want to show you a couple books on oaks. Well, at least this one is solely on oaks. This is Oaks of California. Take a look at the cover here. And if we can get a close-up on this, there you go, Oaks of California. This, if you're interested in oaks, this is not a particularly expensive book. It's a really nice book on oaks. Let's just go ahead and maybe crack it and show you generally. They got a lot of nice photographs of the various species, but more importantly, if you're interested in growing oaks and you want to pick an oak to grow, and I'll just leaf through here and let me go ahead to the it's the very first section talks about all the species of oaks. There are about 18 species of oaks in California, the diversity of oaks, of California oaks. So they'll talk about all the different species. So let's get into some of those species here. The valley oak shows you identifying characteristics, habitat, the black oak. We'll talk about these today because that's what we're talking about today. Shows you distribution, shows you the leaves, the blue oak. So all these oaks, it talks about all the different types of oaks. Oak conservation, the relationships, the coast live oak. We'll talk about these too, but this is a really excellent book on oaks, and it is published by the California Oak Foundation and the Kachuma Press. The Kachuma, of course, are native Indians in California. So that's Oaks of California, really excellent book. And of course, the Sunset Western Garden book, which is our text for this course for students who are enrolled. Of course, we are broadcast from the campus at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. And students sign up and take this as a course. This is a class. And so this is the Sunset Western Garden book. And if you crack it open to the genus for oaks, now the genus for oaks is Quercus. And so you go to Q. And see how fast I can get there. Quercus, here it is, Quercus oak. So anyway, they've got a nice, they got quite a few pages on oaks, and they list a lot of different species of oaks, and then they got a bunch of pictures of oaks across the bottom. So this is also a great resource on oaks if you want to read more about oaks and learn more about oaks in California and oaks around the world. Of course, the genus Quercus occurs throughout the world on many different continents. And so we grow a lot of those non-native oaks here in California, and they do quite well, and they're wonderful trees. And we unfortunately do have some pests. We're going to get into those pests, and we'll talk about ways that maybe we can prevent the spread of those pests to larger areas of California and maybe protect our oaks. Sometimes it's a little sobering and unfortunate that we have so many problems with our oaks right now. So let's talk about oaks. I'll get right into it here. And as I said, the genus name for oak is Quercus. There are about 600 species of oaks worldwide. They are in the beech family, or the Fagaceae. The flowers are catkins, and they are produced in spring. Catkins kind of hang down a little yellow short flower spikes or inflorescences. The fruit is called a nut, and actually more commonly called an acorn. In fact, if a tree has an acorn, that makes it an oak. They are born in a cup-like structure known as a cupule, or the cap. The live oaks are distinguished as being evergreen, but are not actually a distinct group and are instead dispersed across the genus. So even though we'll call an oak a live oak, like a California coast live oak, very closely related to it is the California black oak, Quercus kelloggii, and they will hybridize between each other. They're very closely related, but the black oak is deciduous, and the live oak, of course, is evergreen. It doesn't lose all its leaves all at once. It loses its leaves as it grows new leaves, and so it always has leaves on it, and if it doesn't have leaves on it, you got a big problem. So there are two subgenera and a number of sections. I don't want to really get into that too much. Let's just talk about the three main groups of oaks in California. There are three groups, basically, and they are delineated by color. So that's the easiest way for most people to think about the various oaks in California. There are white oaks. There are red / black oaks. Red and black are really the same group. On the East Coast, they call them red oaks, and on the West Coast, we tend to call them black oaks. But that is the same group, even though, so red and black can be used interchangeably. So you have the white, the red, and the black, and you have golden oaks, or also called intermediate oaks. And these are not artificial groups. They're real in that the oaks within each group can hybridize and make viable seed, but they can't do that between groups. So if you have two different white oak species, like the valley oak is a white oak, and I believe the Engelmann oak is a white oak, and go back and check that to make sure. I should know that. So if you cross an Engelmann with a valley oak, you'll get acorns that will grow a hybrid between the two species. But if you take a California coast live oak and try and cross it with a valley oak, which is a white oak, and the coast live oak is a black oak, you will not get viable seed. They will not cross. That's showing you that these groups are real. They are genetically real. They are real in nature. It's not a perception that we are projecting on these groups, like, you know, separating them into tall and short oaks, or oaks with round leaves and oaks with scalloped leaves. You know, so they're real differences. So now, the white oaks are the largest group of oaks in California. There are 18 species of native oaks in California, and the black oaks are the middle group. The white oaks are the largest group. So the black oaks are the coast live oak, black oak, Santa Cruz oak, which is Quercus parvula, the peninsular oak, which is Quercus peninsularis, and the interior live oak, which is Quercus wislinzii. Now the white oaks is, like I said, the largest of the three groups. And that they include the California scrub oak, which is berberdifolia, Quercus berberdifolia, Mueller's oak, which is Quercus cornelius mulleri, the blue oak, Nuttall scrub oak, which is Quercus domosa, the San Gabriel mountain leather oak, Quercus dorata variety gabrielensis, which is a unique variety of dorata that occurs in the San Gabriel Mountains, Engelmann oak, which is Quercus engelmanni, the Oregon oak, which is Quercus garyana, Tucker's oak, valley oak, Channel Island scrub oak, and the shrub live oak. And so all of those are white oaks. The golden oaks include Cedros Island oak, the canyon live oak, Palmer's oak and island oak. That would be the Cedros island oak is Quercus cedrosinensis. The canyon live oak is Quercus, boy, I've forgotten the species and I don't have it in my note right here. But we'll get to that in a moment. Now the coast, let's talk about oaks and we'll start with our first picture. The most common oak you're going to see in Southern California is the California coast live oak, Quercus agrifolia. Let's bring this picture up full screen. It is a very large tree and can live for well over 100 years. And you can see it has a broad dome. It is, of course, evergreen. That's why you call it a live oak. They reach a height of 20 to 70 feet. Now, rarely would they be limited to 20 feet, and typically they get about 50 feet. It has an equal or greater spread, so it can easily have a 100-foot spread. They're native to coastal, central, and southern California. Really all the way from San Francisco to the border with Mexico and inland about 100 miles. That's where you're going to find California coast-like oak in a natural setting. Of course, they are propagated and sold out of nurseries, so you can literally find them anywhere. They have smooth, dark gray bark, which is deeply fissured in old trees. The leaves are oval, convex, stiff, leathery dark green with a toothed edge, and they are about 1 to 3 inches long. The acorn is conical, 3 1/4 to 1 1/2 inches long, and matures in 1 year. Let's take a look at photo number 2. And you can see the leaves and the acorns for the California coast live oak. And for some reason, my screen's not on. So I don't think I can, I can draw on it. What do you know? So right there is the acorn. And these acorns mature in 1 year. So it will bloom in the spring, produce acorns. And in the fall, they're actually ready to be picked and planted if you want to grow a new tree. Here are the leaves, and they are toothed on the margin, and it's quite a stiff tooth, and they can kind of scratch you a little there. So they're not deeply lobed as many oaks or traditional deciduous oaks are. Now, it drops old leaves in the spring and puts on a new flush of leaves. Usually this occurs in February. Let's take a look at our next picture, which will show you the catkins. Oh no, I guess maybe this is more leaves. Yeah, this is more leaves. And here, of course, are some acorns. They're long and conical. And the leaves are slightly cupped. If you see right around the edge here, it's a little cupped. And of course, they have little teeth on them. You see all these little teeth right along here. And that's really how you can recognize the California coast live oak quite easily, is this distinct leaf. Let's take a look at the next picture, number 4, which shows the flowers. These are called catkins, and you're going to see these this time of year. Here's the new growth, which starts out kind of pink. Here's the old leaves. And as it's growing all this new growth, it's going to start dropping a lot of the old leaves. But these are catkins, and those are the flowers. So another black oak, which is also fairly common in California, is the California black oak, Quercus kelloggii. And let's go to our next picture. Here's Quercus kelloggii. This is a California black oak. It's a large tree, native from Southern Oregon to Southern California, so a very wide distribution in the state. It is deciduous, as opposed to being a live tree or evergreen. They reach heights of 30 to 80 feet, tall and wide. It has a short trunk and a rounded crown. Leaves unfold soft pink in spring, and they mature to a dark glossy green. Leaves yellow or yellow-orange in the fall before they fall off. The leaves are 4 to 10 inches long, 2 1/2 to 6 inches wide, with deep, sharply tapered lobes ending in points. So let's take a look at the next picture, number 6. And these are the leaves of the California black oak. And you can see these deep lobes. Now they're pointed. You see the little points? But then you've got the deep lobes. This is more like a traditional This is what you think of when you think of the silhouette of an oak with these deep lobes. And so now let's take a look at our next picture, which is the acorn. This is the acorn of the California black oak. They are oblong or conical, and you can see here they're quite a bit more spherical or oblong than the California coast live oak, which is long and conical. 1 to 1.5 inches, mature in 2 years. So you can see that even though they're both in the black oak group, the length that it takes of acorn mature is not part of the taxonomy of oaks. I mean, it's a characteristic of a species, but it's not really used within the taxonomy. Now, if we take a look at our next picture, it shows the dark gray, furrowed and checked bark from the California black oak with a California black oak leaf here, just for maybe scale and also to remind you that this is the California black oak. So here you've got this gray bark that's checked like this. This is very similar to a lot of oak bark. Those are two of our black oaks. So come on back. And let's talk about the white oak. The white oak is the valley oak. Our first white oak that we're going to talk about is the valley oak, Quercus lobata. And it is also referred to as the California white oak. It is deciduous, native to interior valleys, the Sierra foothills, and the coast ranges. It does occur in LA County, in the northern reaches of the county. It's not common in LA County, at least naturally. The valley oak tolerates cool, wet winters and hot, dry summers, but requires abundant water for its thirsty root system. It is most abundant in rich, deep soils of valley floors below 600 meters in elevation. This is the oak that Thousand Oaks is named for. So if you're driving out on 101 through Thousand Oaks, and you see, especially in the winter, and you see all these oak trees in the distance with no leaves on them, those are valley oaks. Those are Quercus lobata. Let's take a look at some pictures of Quercus lobata. And this is our first picture, number 9, bringing up full screen. It's a very large tree. And let's see, I can take a quick look. I don't have in my notes how big it gets, but I'm sure it gets roughly the same size as the first two we talked about. And let's see. Often reaching 70 feet or taller with equal or greater spread, massive trunk and limbs with thick, distinctly checked gray bark, straight and erect during its first several decades of growth, more spreading with age. That's from the Sunset Western Garden book. The valley oak is widely distributed in California's Central Valley and the intercoastal ranges south of the Eel River and the transverse ranges from the Tehachapi Mountains to the San Fernando Valley. It is also present on Santa Cruz Island and Catalina Island. Some of the most picturesque stands are found in the Sonoma Valley, Round Valley in Mendocino County, in the upper reaches of the Salinas River. So let's take a look at our next picture, which is a valley oak in fall, because it is a deciduous oak. You see it'll give you some color, kind of a yellowish orange. And then in the winter, here's another picture of the California valley oak in winter, our next photograph, number 11. Here it is. So really a large statuesque tree, a wonderful tree for Southern California. And then the valley oak leaves, let's take a look at those. And you can see they don't have the points that you saw, the sharp points that you saw on the California black oak. And it is more deeply lobed. It has much deeper lobes than you're going to see on the black oak. And they're rounded, and these aren't sharp points, but they're rounded instead of coming to a sharp point. So the leaves are deeply cut, round lobed, 3 to 4 inches long, 2 to 3 inches wide, dark green above, and paler underside. The acorns, let's take a look at some of the acorns. Here are some more valley oak leaves in fall. Let's go to our next picture to show you the color. So they kind of are yellowish to orange. So they'll give you some fall color, especially if that's what you're looking for. And let's take a look at our valley oak leaves and the acorns in our next picture. So here are just some old brown leaves just to show you the range in size, but they are deeply lobed. And the acorns are 1.5 to 2.5 inches. They're conical with a warty bowl-shaped cup, and they mature in 1 year. So here's the cup. You can see that's quite, I don't know if you can see that, but it's quite bumpy or warty. And this is a, this looks, the shape is really the same as the California Coast Live Oak, but it's probably a little longer. And the California Coast Live Oak doesn't have such a warty cap. And it's, of course, California Coast Live Oak is not deciduous. It's not going to have this kind of leaf. So if you look at both the leaves and the acorns, you should get a pretty good idea what type of oak you're looking at. Now, let's take a look at our next oak, which is the Engelmann oak, Quercus engelmannii, which is a pretty big tree too, and an interesting species for a couple reasons. It is, of course, an evergreen oak. It's not deciduous, 40 to 50 feet tall and up to twice as wide. Native to Southern California, mostly in San Diego County, with a population in Eastern Los Angeles County, referred to as a disjunct population distribution. So a long time ago, this oak occurred from LA County all the way down to San Diego County. But at some point in time, the trees in the middle, like in Orange County, died out, and it left a small distribution of them, or a small population of the oak, the Quercus engelmannii, in LA County, and that happens to be at the Los Angeles County Arboretum in Arcadia, and it's also referred to as the Pasadena oak, and there's a lot of them grown in gardens throughout the San Gabriel Valley. It is a popular oak in the San Gabriel Valley. I don't see it a lot of other places. It's also referred to as the Mesa oak. The leaves are thick, leathery, dull greenish, dull bluish green, oval or oblong to 2 inches long, usually smooth-edged. Let's take a look at our next picture, which shows the Engelmann oak leaves. See that they're quite blue, and that's one of the attractive characteristics of this tree, is it has a very distinct blue color. And it is, the acorns are oval to cylindrical, round-tipped to 1 1/4 inches long, half enclosed in a warty cup. So you can see this very warty cup, the blue foliage, the smooth edge. And that's going to tell you you're almost certainly dealing with an Engelmann oak, or Pasadena oak, or Mesa oak. I think more commonly people do refer to it as an Engelmann oak. And so here's, again, the leaf is very blue. It has a smooth edge, not toothed or lobed. This, the acorn is quite exposed compared to a lot of acorns on oaks, sticking out quite a ways. Okay, let's move on to our next oak, which is the blue oak, which is actually a white oak as well. All the oaks we're talking about now are white oaks. This is Quercus douglasii. It is a deciduous tree, 30 to 75 feet tall, with a 40 to 70 foot spread. And it is another magnificent tree, native to Central Valley and interior valleys of Southern California, Trinity and Shasta counties, south through the coastal ranges and along the foothills of Sierra Nevada, Santa Barbara County, North Ventura County, and Northern Los Angeles County. This tree actually does occur in Los Angeles County, which is quite remarkable. You don't see them very often. But I let's come back to me, because I see we have a phone call. And excuse me if I'm coughing my head off a little bit. I've been trying to deal with my cough now for several weeks. I kept getting sick during April. And so let's go to our caller and see what kind of question we get today. Gordon, calling from Los Angeles, you're on the air.
Thank you. I have a question regarding the free compost that I've gotten from the LA City.
Okay.
I noticed that they were in pretty coarse shape. You know, there was a lot of twigs and what have you. First question is, will those decompose with time in the garden?
Yes. Of course, the coarser the chip, the longer it'll take it to decompose. And another key factor in how quickly it decomposes is how wet it gets. If you really don't water very often, if you've got a dry landscape, or say you're growing cactus and succulents and you don't water more than, say, once a month, that wood chip will last probably about a year before it decomposes. If you can go through a winter with decent rain, you'll get pretty rapid decomposition. And especially if your chips are maybe 1 inch to 2 inch, it's going to take about a year or so for that to decompose. If you've got a smaller chip, maybe a half inch chip to 1 inch chip or even smaller, that's going to decompose faster. But it will decompose, absolutely.
Well, they weren't chips. They were like, you know, short little twigs and what have you. They're pretty rough shape.
Well, the small twigs, it'll all decompose.
Okay.
You know, and you're going to see probably a variety or a variation in the quality of the mulch you get at those free distribution centers. You may go one time and find that mostly it's well composted, and the next time you go, maybe it's not as well composted. There's more chip, there's more wood left in it. Because the stream, the waste stream they're getting, varies over the course of the year as well. Some chippers will chip to a smaller chip. Other, you know, the tub grinders, the very large tub grinders that some of the facilities use, will probably produce larger chip. Believe it or not, this is discussed quite a bit.
I see. But I can still dig it into the garden and use it as I would?
Well, with the caveat that if it's a very woody chip, if you got a lot of wood chip in there, branches and large, you know, say 1 inch or to 2 inch wood chips, if you turn that into the soil, as it decomposes, it's going to lock up all the nitrogen in the soil for a period of time, maybe 2 to 4 weeks, even up to 6 weeks. Because when you put a lot of cellulose or wood into the soil, the fungi and the bacteria just start growing on it like crazy, and their population blooms or explodes. And as they grow like crazy, they start using up the nitrogen in the soil. And as they exhaust their food source, they're going to die and then give the nitrogen back. So you do have this phenomena of induced nitrogen deficiency when you use very high cellulose compost or mulches. Like if you just go get sawdust and turn that into the soil, you're going to have a nitrogen deficiency in that soil for a few weeks. And so one way you can mitigate that is by adding a nitrogen source when you add in that wood chip. If you want to turn it into the soil. If you just put it on the surface as a mulching, say under fruit trees or shade trees or shrubs, then you don't have that type of concern. It's not really going to induce nitrogen deficiency that much if it's just on the surface of the soil compared to turning it into the soil. And it would be better to use a better composted material when you're turning it into the soil. You could screen it, too, if you have a screen.
Well, I did take out a lot of the large wood chip and put them on the side. Just use the more fine ones.
Well, you know, and of course, that's free mulch. And if you buy mulch, which I'm loath to do because I'm so cheap, but you can get screened mulch and you can get unscreened mulch. One of the places I purchased mulch is out in Azusa. It's a tree company, and they compost their wood chip, you know, from the tree removals and all the pruning they do. They have two grades. They have the stuff they've screened, which is really nice for mixing in the soil. It's well composted, and there's nothing really over a half an inch, and probably nothing over a quarter inch. And then they got the stuff they haven't screened, and that's going to have some pretty big chips in it. So if you want to go to the work of screening it, you can improve the quality of that, depending on what you're using it for.
Well, I'm putting it into a garden, and it brings me to my second part of the question. What is the ratio that you have to mix the soil with the compost? Is there anything like too much compost?
I'd say you can use too much compost, but you really have to go way overboard to get to the point that it's too much. Is this for a vegetable garden or a flower garden?
Yeah,
a vegetable garden. Okay, well, my general recommendation for that is you put down 4 inches of compost or mulch and turn it into a depth of 4 inches of soil. So you end up with an 8-inch mixture that's 50% soil and 50% compost. That would be heaven for your vegetables.
Well, you know, if I put a trowel into it, it goes right to the bottom. You know, I've dug it pretty deep, and it's pretty loose. But I notice when I water it, or after a day or two of watering, it seems to dry faster than I expected.
Well, when you do water, it has to do with application rate and how long you run your sprinkler, you know, and how you're watering. You really want to soak the soil when you're watering vegetables to about 12 inches or even 16 inches. You're going to want to get the water deeper than you would get a lawn. Lawns aren't that deeply rooted. So that upper 2 or 3 inches will dry out rather rapidly within a day or two. But if you've gotten the water down to 12 inches, then that water is going to be available for a week or two, depending on the season and what you're growing. You know, what you can do after you water is take a rod and shove it in the ground. It should go about as deep as the water went. When you hit dry soil, it'll be difficult to push it. Or you can use a trowel and dig down and see how deep you got it. How do you water your vegetables? Do you use a sprinkler or a drip or a hose or what?
Well, I use a hose and I leave it there, you know, on slow drip and let it sink in.
Well, after you do that, if you do that for like 15 minutes to 30 minutes, to, you know, if you make a basin, I like to make basins around a lot of my plants, my tomatoes and things like that, my fruit trees, and I fill up the basin and then I let it dribble, you know, as it's soaking in, I leave the hose on a dribble, and then I'll come back maybe in 30 minutes and fill it up again. But now that's mostly, and then I'll do that 3 times for the fruit trees because I want a deep, deep soak for things like stone fruits, avocado, citrus. But for the vegetables, I don't have to soak it as deep because they're just not rooted nearly as deep as trees are. So get down to 6 inches or 10 inches and see how much water you got down there, because that upper 3 to 6 inches is going to dry out fairly quickly. And so that might fool you into thinking that the soil's dry when in fact you've got adequate moisture down deeper. And you'll know on a lot of these vegetables, you'll see when they are dry, they'll wilt. So by, you know, you should observe your vegetable garden as often as possible. If not daily, then at least every other day. And then you can see, and really the goal in conserving water, especially when you're growing a vegetable garden or, you know, your whole garden, is you want to extend the period between irrigations as long as possible. And if you can water every 10 days rather than every 7 days, then in 30 days, you're going to water 3 times, where if you watered every 7 days, you'd water 4 times. So that's almost a 25% reduction in how much you're watering if you can extend that period between irrigations. So, you know, your plant will tell you if you're not watering frequently enough. But when you do water, make sure you get a deep soak.
Okay. And then I have one other question.
The other thing I would also recommend is not only do you want to mix that into the soil so you end up with a soil that's very high in organic matter, you want to put a thick layer of it on the surface as well to mulch the surface to prevent evaporation from the surface of the soil.
Okay, I'll do that. Now, I noticed you make a notification of society news and sales and what have you. I would like to have our club, our Orchid Society's auction information broadcast on your show. How do I go about doing that?
Send us an email. We'd love to put it on the show. Absolutely.
Right. It's sometime in May, and it's our annual fundraiser auction. And
well, if you send me an email, and here's our email address, askdhtvlive@gmail.com. With your information, I'll share it with all the viewers, and I'm sure they'd love to hear about your sale.
Well, thank you very much for your time. I enjoy your show.
Well, thank you for viewing, and thank you for your call.
All right, thank you. Bye.
Okay, I see we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Herbert, calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
All right, thank you.
Are you there, Herbert?
Yes, I'm here.
Go ahead. What's your question today?
Yes. My question is, how much water do I need to put on the orange trees?
Okay, that's a great question. Now, it has to do with how old your orange tree is. Let's talk about mature trees that have been in the ground more than 3 years, or you know, something that's been in the ground 5-10 years, and you have an established tree. You should water it once a month in the spring and the fall, and every 2 to 3 weeks in the summer. You're in Los Angeles, but Los Angeles is a big place. What part of LA are you in? You still there, Herbert?
Yes, sir. I'm still here.
What part of Los Angeles do you live in?
I'm in the center section.
Oh, so downtown or in that area?
Yes, sir. By Dodger Stadium.
Oh, okay. Well, it's a little, you're not really on the coastal influence as much as, say, West LA or Santa Monica. You're more like a warm inland valley. Although you're kind of transitional because you're not really all the way into the San Gabriel Valley. You're not up in the San Fernando Valley, which are significantly hotter. But still, what you want to do is apply about 3 inches once a month in March, April, May, and June. Now, in July, August, September, you're going to want to do that twice a month. So, now, when you do water, how do you water your orange tree or your citrus?
Usually, when I water the lawn.
Is it in a lawn?
Yes, sir, it is.
That's not good for the tree.
Oh.
Because lawns are watered frequently and shallow, and fruit trees and shrubs and trees in general and shrubs in general are watered deep and infrequently. So when you do water your orange tree, if it didn't have a lawn around it, you know, if it were on its own, you would put a you could put a hose in sprinkler underneath it, turn it on, and you want to get a sprinkler with a low trajectory, not something that shoots water 10, 15 feet in the air, but something that just has a low trajectory, and water just underneath the canopy of the tree, and put some coffee cups out, and run your and leave that on until you have 3 inches of water in the cups. You can use any straight-sided cup, a tuna can, a coffee cup, and that will soak the soil to a depth of about 2 to 3 feet. In March, April, May, and June, that's all you need to do. Now, but starting in July, you have to do that every 2 weeks. You could probably get away with doing that every 3 weeks where you are, but in the San Gabriel Valley, and it has a lot to do with your soil, too. If you've got a heavy clay, I'd go 3 weeks. If you've got a loam or a sandy loam, I'd go 2 weeks. So you can kind of judge your soil by digging a hole and filling it with water and seeing how fast it drains, or just a general kind of a concept. If you have a heavy soil that stays wet for a long time, then you're dealing with a clay soil. If you've got a soil that drains rather rapidly or at a decent rate, and then after it drains, it doesn't turn into a rock. Like, clays are very difficult. So generally speaking, once a month in the spring and the fall, every 2 weeks in the summer, and you need to apply about 3 inches of water. Now, since you've got it in a lawn, what you should do is clear all the lawn away from the tree out to the edge of the canopy, and then make sure that the lawn sprinklers are not watering the tree itself. So you want to create a little island around that tree that doesn't get watered by the lawn sprinklers. You can change the heads to half heads or three-quarter heads till they spray away from the tree out to the lawn. Or better yet, get rid of your lawn entirely and save a whole lot of water, because lawns will use about 3 to 4 feet of water per year in Southern California, and a citrus tree will use about half of that. So
thank you very much, sir. I really appreciate it.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks for calling in. So let's go back to this camera, I guess. And that's, how often to water your fruit trees is one of the most frequent questions I get at work, where I'm the plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner. And, a lot of people haven't taken a class in horticulture or haven't gone to a lecture on how to grow a garden or maintain a landscape. And so it's really important, that you don't water too frequently, and you don't water for too short run times. Generally, the most common mistake is people water too frequently and their run times are too short. So what they're doing is repeatedly wetting the upper 3 inches of soil, and they're not getting the deep drenches that you want to give to trees and shrubs. You want to get that water down to 2 feet, down to 3 feet, and then you don't need to water again for 2 to 4 weeks. And some trees, you might not even water for 2 months, like an olive tree. They are so drought tolerant. You could water olive trees every other month in the spring and the fall, and once a month in the summer. So that's just a little digression there. Let's go back to our oaks that we were talking about. We were talking about the blue oak. Let's get that picture of that blue oak back up, because it is just a wonderful, wonderful species of oak that's native to California. And let's talk about it again. 30 to 75 feet tall with a 40 to 70 foot spread. Native to Central Valley and interior valleys of Southern California, Trinity and Shasta counties, south through coast ranges and along the foothills of the Sierra Nevada, Santa Barbara County, northern Ventura County, and northern Los Angeles County. And here it is. It's just a spectacular tree. Light gray bark, shallowly checked in small squares. And the leaves are shallowly lobed, oval, very bluish green, 1.5 to 4 inches long, 3/4 to 2 inches wide. Let's go to the next picture, number 18, which shows the blue oak leaves. And so you can see how blue this is. And the other oak, of course, that's quite blue is the Engelmann oak, but this is even bluer, really. It has relatively shallow lobes, not those deep lobes that you saw on the other oak leaves like that. And it's not pointy. They don't have sharp points on the edges of the lobes. You might get a few sharp points, but not really. Mostly they're rounded. You get good fall color from the blue oaks. You get pink, orange, yellow. And let's take a look at our oak. No, we don't want to move on to the next picture yet. I don't have pictures of the actual leaves, but in the fall, you're going to get pink and orange. The acorns are egg-shaped, 3/4 to 1.25 inches long, with sharp pointed tip, mature in 1 year. And I just have the pictures of the leaves and the tree itself. Now, I want to take go to a video here before we finish up on the other species of oaks. There is an invasive beetle that's attacking oaks down in the Cleveland National Forest, and unfortunately it is spreading, so it's not just there, it's spread to a couple other locations, called the gold-spotted oak borer. And there is some discussion about whether it's a native beetle in California or whether it was introduced from Arizona. Most people who are working on this believe it was introduced from Arizona on firewood or somebody bringing logs for whatever purpose from Arizona into California. That is a very good way to introduce wood-boring insects into an area where they didn't exist before. So if you take oak logs from San Diego and take them with you up to the Sierras for a summer camping trip, and then the beetles emerge from your logs before you burn them, or you leave some behind and they don't get burned, you've just moved that beetle hundreds and hundreds of miles that it would never have been able to move on its own. So let's take a look at this clip on invasive beetles, and it is the gold-spotted oak borer that is devastating mostly California coastal live oaks down in the Cleveland National Forest in San Diego County. Let's take a look at this video clip.
This isn't the sound you expect to hear in the serenity of the San Diego County mountains, but these workers, armed with chainsaws, are racing against an invasive creature on a path of destruction. The gold-spotted oak borer beetle has killed 80,000 oak trees in the county over the last decade. The Cleveland National Forest has taken the brunt of the massive die-off.
This is probably the worst invasive insect problem that these oak trees have ever experienced. And as we can see with the tens of thousands of dead oak trees, the problem is only going to get worse over time.
Mark Hoddle is a biological control specialist at UC Riverside.
Oh, two. Look at that. Bonus.
He says the trees are ultimately killed after the beetles burrow their eggs in the underside of the bark and the hatched larvae eat away at the tree.
So you can see how extensive that is.
So when you have hundreds or sometimes possibly thousands of these beetle larvae feeding in these trees that are dying around us, they're essentially cutting the tubes that move the nutrients up and down the tree, and the tree ends up ultimately starving because these tubes have been cut and they can't get their food or water anymore.
The infested trees typically die within 3 to 5 years, a rapid mortality for 150-year-old oaks. The beetle was first discovered in San Diego County in about 2004. Hoddle says it likely came here in a bundle of firewood from its native home in Arizona. There, the beetle is hardly visible because its predators keep it in check.
And here in California, where the climate's great, you know, there's tens of thousands of oak trees for it to attack and no natural enemies, boom, the populations have exploded, and we're seeing the consequences of that now.
Roger Kovalt is supervising park ranger at Heise Park and Campgrounds near Julian, the epicenter of the invasion. His crew has cut down 800 dead trees so far, with hundreds more to go.
The entrance drainage used to have a very full canopy of oak. Now most of the trees are down and the light shines through. It's quite sad. We're losing this canopy and campers miss it.
Kovalt says the onslaught of dead trees has created hazardous conditions for park visitors and campers. Trails and campgrounds are often closed because of unstable trees.
Well, safety is a big issue. They die, they fall, and we don't want them to hurt the public. You also have an increased fire danger with the dried out tree, more likely to burn if a fire comes.
The oak borer has a single generation life cycle and lives for 1 year, but it's capable of producing more than 100 eggs, with 70 to 80% hatching and producing larvae.
Thousands of acres of oak forests in San Diego County face an ecosystem collapse if these beetles can't be contained. The acorns are essential for deer and rodents. Woodpeckers store their nuts in these trees, and they're home to dozens of birds.
And areas that are shaded by these oak trees often hold water and keep these areas damp, and in those areas we find unique plant and animal species that can only live in these moisted areas underneath the shade of these giant oak trees. And all that's in peril now as these oaks die.
Hoddle says invasive species are an accelerating problem in Southern California. Exotic insects are becoming established in the region an average of 1 every 40 days. He says population growth, tourism, and increasing trade are to blame.
So some recent examples, in addition to the gold-spotted oak borer, are brown widows, which many people are now finding in their backyards. We have problems in our citrus orchards now with Asian citrus psyllid, which is native to the Indian subcontinent and Southeast Asia. We have problems with something called the spotted wing Drosophila, which is a very small fly, which now attacks our blueberries, raspberries, and blackberries.
Hoddle is on a mission to track down the gold-spotted oak borer's enemy before it decimates oak forests all the way to Oregon and beyond. He's specifically looking for a parasite that attacks the beetle's eggs and larvae.
We've begun those surveys in southern Arizona. We're expecting that this process may take at least 5 years before we can get natural enemies into California to release against the gold-spotted oak borer.
Hoddle says the question is, in 5 years, will there be any oak trees left to save? Susan Murphy, KPBS News.
Not the cheeriest topic to talk about, but that's not the only pest that's attacking oaks in California. That's just in San Diego County. Unfortunately, the beetle was found in Idlewild, almost certainly arrived there because someone took firewood from the Cleveland National Forest or from, you know, northern San Diego County up to Idlewild to go camping or go to their cabin. And so they found oaks up in Idlewild with a gold-spotted oak borer. I don't know the extent of the infestation there. It's been some time since I heard about those trees that were found there that were infested. And I've heard that it's being found now perhaps in Orange County as well. So it is moving. Unfortunately, it's very difficult to stop it. On their own, they don't travel very far. It's going to be very slow for them to spread. The way they're moved is really through firewood, moving oak that have died, that are infested with the gold-spotted oak borer, moving the branches and the split logs. If you debark it, then you'll probably, you know, they can't be spread. Now, I don't have a photograph to show you on the screen, but let's go to the overhead. I want to show you what the gold-spotted oak borer looks like. And there's a couple key characteristics that'll tell you if you've got gold-spotted oak borer. One, let's take a look at the beetles themselves. If we can go to the overhead, I'll show you. They're not very big. You could probably fit 10 of them on a penny. Here they are on this handout that various, I'm not sure who produced this, but here are the beetles, and they've got these six yellow golden spots in pairs. There's three pairs. And you can see there's two here on this penny, and you can imagine you could put maybe 8 to 10 of them on a penny. They're not very big. And then, of course, there's a nice dead oak tree that was killed by it. And this is actually from, who published this? University of California Cooperative Extension, which was one of the major sources of information on exotic pests. And the big message, of course, is don't move firewood. Burn it where you buy it. They've got these posters. Buy it where you burn it. So if you're going to go up to the Sierras and you go camping, you want to have a little campfire when you're camping, you want to buy your wood when you get there. Go up and buy some firewood, but don't try and bring it with you unless you're bringing something like scrap lumber that doesn't have any bark on it, or if you can debark your firewood. The other thing would be to tarp it and keep it for some extended period, because then it'll probably decay. And here's a slightly bigger one that says, buy it where you burn it. Don't move firewood. That's a great way to move pests. And this isn't the only disease of trees that can be moved around by moving wood. There's also pine pitch canker, which affects Monterey pines along the central coast. And if you move, if those trees die, if those Monterey pines die from that disease, then you move the wood hundreds of miles to go, take it someplace. Then you're going to move that disease around too, and that's a fusarium disease. So anyway, I have this little kit that I got at one of the meetings, and they give out all this stuff, and it shows, of course, the gold-spotted oak borer here. And let's see if I can, I don't know if you're going to see this, the real distinct characteristic for the gold-spotted oak borer is these D-shaped exit holes when the beetles leave the tree. And here's a piece of wood that was from a tree that was killed. And let's go to the overhead. And I don't know how close you can get in on this, because normally when a wood-boring beetle exits a tree, it usually leaves a nice circular hole. The size of that hole will give you a clue as to which beetle that might be. There's a very large hole that you often see on coast live oaks. And that's the sycamore wood borer, which also goes to California coast live oak. And they've been here forever. But if you can look in on this right here, I don't know if you can, there's the hole. There's the hole right there. And this side over here is kind of straight. It's kind of D-shaped. And you can see that it's not very big. It's about the size of a pencil lead, not the size of pencil. So that's probably about an eighth inch, or between a 16th and an eighth, and not a quarter inch. There's another exit hole here as well. So these exit holes with this D shape, with a straight line across there and then around on the other side, making that D shape, is indicative of, or diagnostic for, the gold-spotted oak borer. And I've had people call me up and say, come on back to me. I've got the gold-spotted oak borer. I know I've got the gold-spotted oak borer. And I said, well, you have it in hand. You've got the beetle. They go, no, I just have holes in my tree. And I said, well, how big are the holes? Oh, they're about as big as a pencil and they're round. Well, then that's going to be the sycamore wood borer, which has been around before Europeans ever showed up in North America. Maybe even before the Native Americans migrated across the Bering Sea or the Bering Straits. So California coast live oaks and sycamores get the sycamore wood borer, which is a clear-winged moth. It's not a beetle. Of course, I've never seen the moth in nature. I've seen photographs of it, of course, but I've never actually seen one. You'd have to go around at night to find one, and they look like wasps. Clear-winged moths mimic wasps, and so they've got black bodies with yellow stripes and clear wings, and they look very much like a wasp. Well, it's the top of the hour. We'd like to take a break here and remind you, you're watching Dominguez Hills Television, broadcast from Cal State University Dominguez Hills. And was just let you know all the wonderful things that happen on campus here. This is an active, vibrant university atmosphere, wonderful campus, wonderful place to go to school. And so let's see if we're ready for that video. Okay, let's go to our station break and remind you, you're watching Dominguez Hills Television, broadcast from Cal State University Dominguez Hills in beautiful Carson.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University Dominguez Hills.
The 2015 Special Olympics World Games will be the largest sporting and humanitarian event to take place in 2015. We're very excited that LA was chosen for this event, and even more excited that the city of Carson and the university have decided to take part in the host town program.
Almost 200 million people around the world have intellectual disabilities. The late Eunice Kennedy Shriver had an incredible vision that she could change their lives through the simple power of sports, and thereby transform communities around the world as they come in contact with our athletes.
And I'm even happy too that I get to see two of my close athletes, friends, and Special Olympics has totally, totally changed my life.
Mrs. Shriver's vision has resulted in more than 4.2 million athletes in 177 countries around the world participating in about 70,000 events a year in Special Olympics.
CSUDH is very, very thrilled then to continue this long tradition by hosting a delegation of athletes and their coaches as they prepare to compete in the 2015 Special Olympics World Games. I wish to acknowledge Mayor Jim Deere and the Carson City Council for inviting CSUDH to partner with them in host town duties.
This campus is the most ethnically diverse campus in the entire system. And so the message that was just given to you about the inclusion, the diversity, it's so poignant and appropriate for Carson and Cal State University Dominguez Hills.
And it is so much more meaningful and heartwarming when we have a personal connection with them, because they'll be living with us and our students and the campus during July.
Inside the Circle of Acceptance and Inclusion, which is our primary mission, and the multicolors represent the diversity of 177 countries and the diversity of Los Angeles, and how we can reach every corner of this community with the message of acceptance and inclusion. To the mayor of the city, to the city council, and to the provost of California State University, Dominguez Hills, congratulations on being named an official host town.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as an entertainment doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folk tale or we create a folk tale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
To be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride.
Succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
In Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
To DHTV on Tuesday night for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Hi, my name is Mar Briones and I'm a junior here at California State University Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And today we're talking about oak trees and the various native oaks that occur in California, and then we'll talk about some non-native oaks as well. We just saw a film clip on the gold-spotted oak borer and the damaging the damage it is doing to oaks down in the Cleveland National Forest, where they've got some pretty stark mortality rates, probably up around 80-90% in some areas. So that's pretty scary, really, if you're a tree lover or a tree hugger. Let's go on to our next oak, which is the Oregon oak, Quercus garyana. It's also known as the Gary oak. Let's see here. That's our next picture, number 19. And this is a deciduous tree that reaches 40 to 90 feet in height with a 30 to 60 foot spread. So it's a little more columnar than you would see in many oaks. Native from British Columbia to the California transverse ranges. So it doesn't really occur in Southern California much. The bark is gray. The branches are often twisted. The leaves are leathery, 3 to 6 inches. Let's take a look at the Oregon oak leaves, which is our next photo, number 20. They are 3 to 6 inches long, oval with rounded lobes, glossy dark green above, and rusty or downy beneath. So that will really be a distinguishing characteristic for this species, is the downy appearance underneath the leaves. If we could bring up number 20. The leaves turn reddish brown in the fall. So this is, again, it looks like a pretty standard deciduous oak kind of leaf, but it's not that deeply lobed, and this is very rounded and nice lobes, but not as deep as some of the others we've seen, like on the valley oak. And so they turn a rusty, a reddish brown in the fall. And the acorns, let's take a look at 21, take a look at the acorns from the Oregon oak, Quercus garyana. They are globular, really kind of spherical, but kind of squished a little bit. They are edible, and of course I think actually almost all the acorns are edible, but you have to leach them after you crush them or grind them. They are up to 1.25 inches long. They are bulging from small scale-covered cup, and they mature in 1 year. So you can see the warts on this cap quite nicely. And of course, here are the typical leaf that we just saw earlier. But this is really a unique kind of a shape. You know, really, the acorn's going to be like this. It's kind of, you know, round, much rounder than the ones that are very conical. Okay, that covers all the white oaks. Those were all white oaks. We started with the black oaks. We looked at a couple blacks. Now we just looked at the whites. Let's move on to the golden oaks or intermediate oaks. This is the smallest group of oaks in California. And the first one we want to look at is Quercus chrysolepis, which is the canyon live oak. Let's take a look at that, number 22. Bring these leaves up. And it is an evergreen tree. 20 to 60 feet tall and wide, native to the foothills and desert mountains from southwest Oregon to Baja California. Very wide distribution. The bark is smooth and whitish when young, checked and gray when old. Now bring up the next picture, which is number 23. Now, before you do, okay, yeah, that's fine. You notice that on this, the margins are smooth. But there's a few teeth on that. Let's go back to the picture we just looked at. Number 22, go back one picture. And you see on this one, the margins are all toothed. The thing about this tree, the canyon live oak, which is Quercus chrysolepis, is that you can have both of these leaves on the same tree. And so it can look, you know, you can have a tree with all smooth margins, and you have a tree with all toothed margins, or you can have a tree with both. And so if you see a tree that's got both, it really tells you you're looking at Quercus chrysolepis, the canyon live oak. The other thing is if we go on to our next picture, which is the canyon live oak acorn, you'll see why these are called golden oaks. It's because the cup is golden yellow, or the cap is golden yellow, right there. And let's take a look at, let's see here, the leaves are oval, 1 to 2 inches long, smooth-edged or spiny, and that's really a distinguishing characteristic. You'll have both on the same tree, smooth-edged leaves and toothed or spiny leaves. The acorns are oblong, sharp-tipped, 2 inches long. That's quite long. It's longer than a lot of other oaks. Enclosed to two-thirds in turban-like cap covered with golden fuzz. And this is why these are called golden oaks, is because of that cap. It is most widely distributed and variable of all California oaks, and it's highly adaptable. So we've looked at the leaves of the and we've looked at the acorns. Now the other group of oaks are that are native are the scrub oaks. And there's a handful of scrub oaks. And this let's take a look at Quercus dorata. There's also Quercus domosa. Scrub oaks are of course, shrubs. They don't become full-sized trees. And this one, and they are, not all of them are golden oaks, but this is the Quercus dorata. And let's see if it's, there's a discussion or a description of them in, they have domosa and dorata. It's called leather oak or nuttle scrum oak, evergreen shrub, native to northern coast ranges to San Luis Obispo and to Sierra foothills, south to San Gabriel Mountains. Dense rounded growth to 10 feet and 8 to 12 feet wide, bare and somewhat leggy to 3 to 5 feet above ground, then forms open branched tiers of foliage, tough, oval, convex, 3/4 to 1 inch long leaves. Let's take a look at our next picture, 26. And you can see the leaves themselves. And here are the leaves on this Quercus dorata. Now there's also Quercus domosa, which is a coastal scrub oak, which is more common in Southern California. Although, actually lately I've seen that the domosa, Quercus domosa is now considered to be only occur on the Channel Islands, on Catalina Island and some of the other Channel Islands, and they're using a different name for the scrub oaks we see in the San Gabriel Mountains. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our next caller. Who do we have now on our calling in? Terry, calling from Pasadena. You're on the air.
11 this morning.
Excuse me?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. What's your question today?
Okay, I saw you on Channel 11 this morning, and you were talking about how it takes 3 to 4 feet of water per year to water a lawn.
Yeah.
I wanted to know, how is that calculated?
Okay, well, that's a good question. I was interviewed on a Fox 11 news program, and it was broadcast this morning at 9 o'clock. It's called Midday Sunday. And they invited me in to talk about tips to conserve water in gardens. And of course, what I often tell people is that a lawn in Southern California will use 3 to 4 feet of water per year in order to keep it alive. That's calculated based on evapotranspiration rates. And I guess I need to explain evapotranspiration. Evapotranspiration is the total water loss from the soil. water that moves from the roots up into the shoots and out into the air. That's transpiration through the plant, and then evaporation is from the surface of the soil. Historically, we lose 1 inch a week in the spring and the fall, and 2 inches a week in the summer, and about 0.5 inch a week in the winter. Now, assuming that it would rain in the winter, if it ever does again, you don't need to water your lawn very much in the winter. But if you add up 1 inch a week, and now lawns need nearly all of that back. The ET rate is actually a reference evapotranspiration rate. It's how much water a cool season grass would use if it were 4 inches tall in an open field. How much water would that use? And so everything else is kind of reference to that. Now the odd thing, of course, is that you can water a cool season grass like a tall fescue, like Marathon or Medallion, some of the most popular turf that is grown now in Southern California. They're called tall fescues. They will do fine with 80% of the evapotranspiration rate. So once a week in the spring and the fall, you need to apply about 8/10 of an inch. Let's just round that off to an inch for easy calculation. So that would be 4 inches in March, April, May, and June. That's 16 inches. And then for 3 months, July, August, September, you're going to do, it goes up to 2 inches a week, but you could probably get away with an inch and a half. So that would be 6 inches, and that's another 18. 18 and 16, 28, 34. So you're up to 34 inches. Now you got the fall, and you're probably going to have to do another October. November is going to be another 8, so now you're already up to about 42 inches. If you water in the winter, you're going to go up to close to 45 to 48 inches. So the way you calculate that is based on evapotranspiration rates that we know historically, what it averages year to year, and the fact that turf needs about 80% of that back. That's called the crop coefficient. Now, if you're growing a Bermuda grass or a St. Augustine grass, you could probably use closer to the 3 feet per year. If you're growing a tall fescue like Marathon or Medallion, you're going to be up into the closer to 4 feet of water per year. If you're in a hot inland valley, you're going to be closer to the 4 feet. If you're at the coast, you're going to be closer to 3 feet. So it's a range. If you're growing a warm season grass like a Bermuda or a St. Augustine along the coast, you might be able to get away with even less than 3 feet, but it's still far more water than any other aspect of your landscape. Grasses are shallow rooted compared to trees and shrubs. That upper soil profile dries out rapidly. Grasses need to be grown in the full sun, in the heat of the summer. That upper soil profile will dry out in 48 hours, and you gotta water again. So you're watering almost every other day. And a lot of that evaporates. So that's how you calculate it, based on ET and crop coefficient. And the fact that grasses guzzle water. Okay?
Okay, well, thanks a lot. I understand it a little bit better. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes, we had a phone call from Fox 11 News from Tony Valdez, and he asked if someone from our department could come in and be on his show called Midday Sunday. And so I went on Friday and he taped it and it was broadcast this morning. And since we've had a call about it, why don't we run that brief interview that I had with Tony on Friday and they broadcast today. Let's go to this video because I actually have it queued up. I was thinking of showing it anyway. And now we've got a call about it. Why don't we go ahead and show this video talking about tips to save water in your garden.
Red light camera ticket dismissed.
I got pulled over.
Oh, let's see. We had a little problem. We don't like to show ads. that's kind of a problem for us, broadcasting advertisements. Let's see if we can go to that video. Okay, the video's ready now.
The senior biologist, and you're involved in plant pathology as well?
I'm senior biologist, plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner.
Which means you're looking at this whole, was it 5,000 square mile area here in Los Angeles County, whatever it may be?
Well, our mission is to prevent the introduction of exotic pests into California, and Los Angeles County has two of the main entry points for exotic pests into the state, the harbor and the airport.
Okay. But you're also, your office is also, or the agriculture commissioner's office is also responsible for weights and measures.
That's true.
That's another part of it. But what we want to talk about today is watering, irrigating, and lawns. That's the first thing that people are thinking about, right?
Well, lawns use a tremendous amount of water, more than any other element of a landscape. A typical lawn in Southern California will use 3 to 4 feet of water per year to keep it green.
And when we talk about feet of water, we're talking about cubic feet?
No, no. When you talk about irrigating landscapes or farms or plant material at all, you talk about it in inches, just the way you measure rainfall. So if it rains... That interview that I was broadcast this morning on Channel 11, you can go to their website and find it under Midday Sunday. And so...
Red light camera...
Whoop. Let's go ahead and talk about... we were just finishing up on the scrub oaks. But let's now move on to some of the non-native oaks that you often see in Southern California. And some of them are really interesting trees. They're not native, but they still do quite well here. And the first one we want to talk about is the cork oak, Quercus suber. And let's bring up our first picture of that, number 27. This is really a unique oak, wonderful oak, and does quite well in Southern California. And just want to make sure you can see it here. And Quercus suber, it is native to Western Mediterranean, North Africa. It reaches 30 to 60 feet high and wide. The trunk and main limbs are covered with thick, corky bark. It is the cork of commerce. The leaves are toothed, 3 inches, oval leaves, shiny dark green above, gray beneath. So I want to go. So here is one out, you know, big, huge, beautiful Quercus suber. But let's take a look at 28 and take a look at this part of the oak. And this is the thick, very thick, spongy bark, which is used to make cork for all applications, such as in wine bottles. And now let's take a look at the cork oak acorns. And the acorns are egg-shaped with a short point, 3/4 to 1.5 inches long, covered by 1/3 to 1/2 in the cup. Let's see. And of course, here you can see the cork oak leaves. They look a lot like a California coast oak leaf. The cup, of course, is a little, kind of has that, I guess I want to describe it as warty. But the leaf really looks quite a bit like a California coast oak leaf. But if you look at the bark, you'll see that it's, you know, this thick, spongy bark. And let's take a look at how they actually harvest this cork oak bark. Let's take a look at number 30. And you can see here they've stripped all the bark off of the lower part. And here's the bark that they didn't rip off. So this is how they harvest the cork. I don't know that that's particularly good for the tree. In fact, I can guarantee that's not good for the tree. But if you don't take it all off, if you don't take it down and expose, you know, take off the meristem, then maybe it could survive. And imagine that's pretty destructive practice, but you know, they may grow them. Mostly this is done in the Mediterranean and probably Spain and Italy and places where these grow naturally. But this is the source of cork. And I heard years ago that they did have a big disease problem on it with Phytophthora cinnamomi. The next one we want to talk about is Quercus ilex, the hollyoak. This is, of course, hollyoak is quite commonly found in Southern California. Very common, often used as a street tree. And let's take a look at a hollyoak, or also known as the holm oak, evergreen, native to Mediterranean. 30 to 60 feet tall. I rarely see them reach much more than 30 feet, to tell you the truth. A dense, rounded head, smooth, dark gray bark. Leaves vary in shape and size, but are usually oval to lance-shaped. And we can take a look at our next picture, which shows the leaves and the acorns. The leaves are 1 to 3 inches long, smooth or prickly edges, another one that can have both. Of course, here you see that all the leaves are smooth. They kind of, the leaf comes to a nice fine tip. They are rich dark green on top, covered with gray or yellow hairs beneath. Acorns are egg-shaped, nearly round, 1.5 inches across. Gray-brown with darker lines, half enclosed in a deep cap that tapers to the stem. So they're long and tapered. They're not globose or ovule. Ovule, and the cap itself is not warty. They can grow at a fairly fast rate inland, but varies with soil and water conditions. A good evergreen tree for street or lawn, where coast live oak is difficult to maintain, though it lacks the tree's open grace. And it can be clipped into hedges as well. So this is the Quercus ilex, the holly oak. And it is actually quite common. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is also Quercus ilex, showing the catkins. Let's bring this up, and you can see the catkins on this tree. If we can bring this up full screen and get a good look at what a catkin is. Here are the catkins, and you get these in the spring. And of course, again, you can see these long linear leaves, or they're not what you see in a lot of oak leaves like this that are deeply lobed at all. They have smooth edges. They can be spiny, not quite as spiny as you'll see on Chrysolepis, and not as variable as Chrysolepis. But so this is the holly oak. And it's a nice tree and widely available. And let's take a look at our next picture, which is the Quercus ilex acorns. And you can see the cap isn't particularly warty, but it has very long conical acorn, not round and globose like some of the others we looked at. Now the other one we want to look at is Quercus robar. That's our next picture, which is the English oak. And let's see, Quercus robar or Quercus rubra. That's the red oak or northern red oak. I wonder why. Oh, here it is, Quercus robar, English oak, deciduous tree. It is native to Europe, of course, England. Fairly fast grower to 50 to 60 feet, 30 feet wide with rather short trunk and very wide open head. The leaves are dark green. Let's take a look at our next picture, number 36. There it is. This one is probably a very, very old oak that's just hanging on. The leaves with 3 to 7 pairs of rounded lobes. Leaves hold until late fall without much color change. Acorns are 1.5 inches long, vary in shape from oval to oblong, coming to an abrupt point at tip, covered by up to 1/3 in velvety bowl-shaped cap. And there are a number of cultivated varieties that have some differences in shape and form. And let's take a look at our last picture, actually, number 35, Quercus robar leaves. And here you can see the acorns from the English oak and the typical oak leaf. They're not that deeply lobed like you saw in some of the valley oak, Quercus lobata. And so that's most of the oaks you're going to encounter if you're out looking at trees in Southern California. And so we covered a lot, really most of the natives and some of the non-natives that are popular here. We do have a problem on some of the oaks. And I don't know, this English oak, they had two big ones at the Huntington that were killed by the polyphagous shothole borer. And that's now becoming a real serious threat to a lot of different trees. It has a very broad host range. At least it looks like it's going to be even broader than it should be or would be acceptable in a way. When you get a new introduced pest, you hope it only attacks a very narrow range of plant materials. But in this polyphagous shottle borer, it's actually attacking, now the list is up to 35 tree species. Now the maples are the number one host, but it's also going to oaks. So you can find it on coastline oak, but it's not a preferred host, and you usually don't find a heavy infestation on California coastline oak. But those English oaks at the Huntington, which were about 50 to 75 feet tall with enormous trunks, both of those were heavily infested and died and have been cut down and they're long gone. So I'm not sure I would grow an English oak right now in Southern California. They also get powdery mildew. I see that on them quite frequently. You can get powdery mildew also on some of our native oaks, but every year I tend to see it on the English oaks. I don't see it very often on California coastline oak, and of course I don't see the other oaks all that often. You don't see blue oaks and Oregon oak and really the valley oak. You don't see that very much unless you go out to to Thousand Oaks, and you can see it there a lot. There is, of course, in addition to the gold-spotted oak borer, we've got several other threats to oaks in California. And I just mentioned the polyphagous shothole borer, which is a real serious threat to oaks. But we also have sudden oak death, and I've talked about this a little bit in the past, especially when I was talking about killer plant diseases, but I want to cover that again today. And sudden oak death started about 1995, at least it was first observed in 1995, with an increased oak mortality rate up in the Bay Area, up in Santa Cruz County and Marin County. And what they observed were bleeding cankers on the trunks. And then the tree would look fine in March, April, May, June. It's nice and green. The summer heat comes in July. Boom, the tree turns brown in 4 weeks. So it was called sudden oak death. And of course, when they go look at these dead trees, they've got these bleeding cankers. And then they're quickly attacked by a couple different bark beetles or oak wood borers, so the western oak borer. And there's a couple beetles that will attack them. Then they'd also start getting these fruiting bodies on them, these little black half-dome fruiting bodies. It's called the devil's bunion, a common name. It's and now the name for the fungus has kind of dropped out of my mind, but the name has been changed a few times. And that's just a saprophyte that's getting on the tree as it's dying. So anyway, it was not until 2000 that it was discovered what was causing these cankers and killing the oaks. It was a new species of Phytophthora. It was published in 2001 as Phytophthora remorum. That was done in Dave Rizzo's lab up at UC Davis. And then in 2004, it was discovered, and actually before that, it was realized that this pathogen, Phytophthora remorum, which was causing the cankers on the oaks, was also causing leaf spots on probably what I would say is a large different number of species that are commonly used as ornamentals in Southern California, particularly rhododendrons, camellias, viburnum, also found on California natives that grow in associated oaks, ceanothus, toyon, California buckeye. So there's two kinds of hosts for sudden oak death. There's the oaks that get the cankers and it girdles the tree and kills the tree. And then there's the leaf spot hosts, which are the camellias, rhododendrons, and viburnum. And the list is up to about 100 species. And so up in the Bay Area where this is killing oaks, now there's 14 counties where oaks are infected and dying. And the rest of the state, we don't have it on our oaks, but we have found it in nursery production on those ornamentals, on camellias. In 2004, it was discovered at a very large wholesale nursery in Azusa, and they had to destroy about 1 million camellias worth about $10 million, and it took about 3 months to destroy them all. They had to be double bagged and buried at a landfill. And that started a federal quarantine for the disease and a state quarantine for the disease. The quarantine has been modified over the years, and just recently, just within the last month or so, most of the state has been deregulated because we're not finding nursery production anymore. The nurseries really responded wonderfully to this. They, you know, of course, it was terrible if you found it on your camellias or on any of your plant materials in your nursery, because then you couldn't sell those plants. They had to be destroyed. It cost them a lot of money. It disrupted their business tremendously. And so they did a lot of things to prevent their plants from getting infected. And apparently very effectively, because in LA County, we haven't had a positive nursery for Phytophthora remorum for probably 4 or 5 years. I have to go back in my records to see exactly how long it's been since I had a positive nursery. But now our nurseries in LA County are deregulated because we are a regulated county, not a quarantine county. The 14 quarantine counties start at Santa Cruz and go up all the way to Humboldt County. So anyway, I'll have a little video clip talking about sudden oak death. I'd like to go to that video, and then we'll talk a little bit more about sudden oak death, and we'll talk about how to plant acorns and how to pick their acorns and get good acorns that'll grow new trees. Let's go to this video clip on sudden oak death.
This is my beautiful tree, Amy. I have lived in this house 34 years, and when I walked out the first time and saw the tree, I knew I had to buy the house. It's been my protector for 34 years, and now it's got sudden oak death.
In the 500 years since it first sprouted from a single acorn, this coast live oak tree outside Susan's house in West Marin County has endured a lot. Storms, drought, habitation by animals, and human encroachment. But the mighty oak may have finally met its match in a tiny organism called Phytophthora remorum, which causes sudden oak death.
I don't know if I'm going to be able to save it. It's not looking real promising. It's not looking promising at all. You know, I said to my husband, I don't know if I can live in the house if it's gone. I cannot be here when they take it away.
P. remorum is a fungus-like organism related to the one that caused the Irish potato famine of the 1840s. Once an oak is infected with the pathogen, the disease causes dramatic symptoms like bleeding cankers, brown leaves, and weakened limbs. Most trees die within 2 to 3 years.
Okay, so this is a clump of trees. They're all dead because they died recently. And then look at it here. Just the trail goes through what I call the tunnel of death. All these branches, all these trees are dead on top of the trail. I'm Matteo Garbellotto. I'm a forest pathologist at the University of California, Berkeley. A plant pathologist is a scientist who studies diseases of plants. Oh, this is beautiful. It's beautiful in its horror. I know sometimes we pathologists seem to think things are beautiful that are not really beautiful.
In 2000, Matteo Garbellotto was recruited to join a group of scientists investigating the mysterious mortality of thousands of oak trees in California since the mid-1990s.
What are you seeing here?
Okay, what I see is healthy cambium here, and I see cambium that's being killed by Phytophthora remorum. So all the brown area here is all colonized by the sudden or death pathogen.
How does a tree work, and how does this disease affect the tree?
Well, you know, the cambium is the only part of the tree that's actually alive and capable of growing. So when Phytophthora remorum kills the cambium, basically it makes it impossible for the tree to grow. And on top of that, this is the layer that's used by the tree to exchange nutrients from the crown into the roots. And then from the roots, they go back up into the crown using the outer part of the wood. So nutrients cannot go up from the roots into the leaves, and then carbohydrates, sugars cannot go from the leaves into the roots. And both these flows are necessary for a plant to grow.
In the last decade, well over 1 million oak and tan oak trees in 14 counties in California, from Humboldt to Monterey, have died, with more than 1 million more infected. Tan oak is a member of the beech family, but although it's technically not an oak, tan oak populations, like this one near Inverness, are some of the hardest hit.
If you were to count how many tan oaks are alive, you would be down maybe in the 10th percentile. So at least 90% of the tan oaks in this forest stand are infected, and as you can see, they're dying. So
the loss of oak and tan oaks may have dire ecological consequences, including soil erosion, increased fire risk, and loss of habitat for wildlife.
Yeah, no, this is dead. I mean, at this point, you see.
Scientists still don't know how to stop the disease, but in recent years, they have found important clues. A major breakthrough for Matteo and his team came in 2001. They realized that the disease was being spread to oaks by other plants called host plants. These carriers, like Douglas fir, bay laurel, and redwood, often don't die, but they act as a breeding ground for the disease, whose spores can be spread by wind, rain, wildlife, and humans.
After about a year of research, we realized that it was not the oak that was giving the infection to the other oak, but it actually was the bay trees that were in the middle that were infecting the oaks in the area.
Oh yes, on the leaf tips here, huh?
And this is also how we think the disease was introduced here, you know, through a carrier host, not bay, but maybe an ornamental plant, and the infection would have looked like something like this, so not very conspicuous, and those plants were traded, sold, and this is how the infection arrived in California, most likely.
In 2006, Matteo and his colleagues published a genetic analysis of the sudden oak death pathogen. Their study provided new evidence that the commercial plant trade inadvertently introduced the microbe to the United States. And while its exact origin remains a mystery, research has confirmed that the pathogen can be spread to oaks and other wild plants by infected nursery plants. So far, more than 100 plant species have been found to be affected by P. remorum, many of which are found in nurseries worldwide. Here in California, dozens of common nursery plants, like rhododendron and camellia, have been identified as carriers. It's a situation that's hit California's $3 billion nursery industry hard.
I've been working with the nurseries for about 18 years now. This is by far the largest problem like this that we have faced.
Within the nursery industry, which is the third largest agricultural business in California, the disease has become such a major concern that several U.S. states and foreign countries have imposed strict regulations regarding the commercial trading of host plants shipped from California. And nurseries have been forced to shoulder an additional expense, the widespread testing of their plants for the disease.
The fact that Phytophthora ramorum has been found in California and in nurseries has drastically changed the way we do business. We have taken great steps in terms of certification and inspections of all nurseries in the state. In addition to that, nurseries that grow host plants are actually DNA tested.
More than a decade has passed since sudden oak death started killing California's oak and tan oak trees, and a cure has yet to be found. But efforts to understand and defeat the disease continue in earnest. In March 2007, the California Oak Mortality Task Force invited hundreds of plant pathologists, forestry managers, and regulators from around the world to Santa Rosa to discuss the very latest research and management strategies. They're also learning about the toll that this disease has taken on some of the residents of Northern California, like the Cashaya Pomo tribe in Sonoma County.
We are a culturally practicing tribe, and acorns and tan oaks are something that are very sacred to us. And so sudden oak death coming in and starting to affect us has been a very scary experience for us.
Within this seemingly dark landscape, there are some glimmers of hope. In recent years, biologists have found that treating individual oak trees with a phosphonate solution makes some trees resistant to the disease. But the treatment is time-consuming and expensive, and it doesn't always work.
Does this treatment have any effect on trees that are already infected, or is it a completely prophylactic treatment?
The bottom line is that it hasn't shown good efficacy in terms of holding back infections that are already established, which partly...
Ultimately, the most promising hope for a solution may lie in genetics. At UC Berkeley, Mateo's research group is working with the U.S. Forest Service on a four-year project to sprout thousands of tan oak acorns from different regions of California. Their goal? To test whether some populations of tan oaks may have a genetic resistance to the pathogen, and if so, why?
In some respect, the way I look at this is that this is the future of tan oak in California. So if we have resistance in tan oak in California, we should be able to see some of that resistance through this experiment. And hopefully we may be able to harness this resistance and we may be able to use it to replenish tan oak population that have been devastated by sudden oak death. And look, when you look through the...
It's a situation with precedent. 100 years ago, a fungal disease imported from Asia wiped out millions of chestnut trees in the eastern United States. Today, whether with genetic testing, better regulation of nurseries, or yet-to-be-discovered strategies, scientists and forestry managers are increasing their efforts to ensure that California's oak and tan oak trees don't meet the same fate. But for now, the killer is still at large.
This pathogen is not going anywhere. It's staying here forever, and we'll have to learn how to live with it. And some management practices will actually favor the pathogen, and some management practices will actually slow down its spread. So we need to learn which ones are which.
So, that's sudden oak death, and that kind of, you know, explains a lot of the details and the biology of sudden oak death, which is caused by Phytophthora ramorum. They did mention in that clip that it's related to the cause of late blight of potato and tomato, which is Phytophthora infestans, is the pathogen that causes late blight of tomatoes and potatoes. And of course, in 1845, late blight wiped out all the potatoes in Ireland. And it did that repeatedly from 1845 to 1848 for 3 years. The famine continued until about 1850. And 1 million Irish starved to death, and 1 million Irish immigrated out of Ireland. The population of Ireland didn't recover for more than 50 years, more like 75 years. They never really recovered to that population level for just a tremendous amount of time. And at that time, of course, in 1845, there was no germ theory of disease. People didn't get sick because you were infected with a bacteria or a virus. you got sick because your neighbor was dancing in the forest at night. So it wasn't until the 1870s that a Swiss scientist, Anton de Berry, was looking at late blight on potato and said, you know, this stuff growing out of the backs of the leaves is causing the disease, late blight. And he was widely criticized and poo-pooed that that was silly, that these microscopic organisms couldn't cause disease. Of course, he was right. He created or named the genus Phytophthora. Phytophthora means the plant destroyer. Phyto means plant. Thora means to kill or die. So Phytophthora means the plant destroyer or killer. And the first species described was by Anton de Berry, Phytophthora infestans, which causes late blight. And since then, about 100 species or so have been described. And so when the oaks started dying up in Marin County and in Monterey County and all the way up to Humboldt, it took about 5 years, and then a new species was isolated from the cankers, and it was described in 2001 as Phytophthora remorum. Remorum means branch, because these cankers occur on the trunks and way up in the canopy, 30 feet up on large scaffold branches. And it was quite mystifying as to how the Phytophthora, the pathogen, was getting so high up in the canopy, because typically most species of Phytophthora are soil-borne. They're in the soil. So often you will see cankers on the trunks of trees that are infected with Phytophthora, but it's usually coming from the roots, starting as a root rot, moving up the trunk, causing a bleeding canker, or might splash onto the trunk from mud during rain. But mud is not going to splash during rain 30 feet in the air. So how was it getting up on those large branches? It was believed for a while, or at least suspected, that perhaps these beetles, these oak wood borers, were actually moving it. But you never found this organism, the Phytophthora remorum, on them. And it turned out that one of the leaf spot hosts, which is the California bay, which is, and I've forgotten the genus, it's Umbellaria californica, California bay, not to be confused with the sweet bay or the regular bay tree, which, and I've forgotten that one too, but I'll remember it in a second. Both of them are hosts for Phytophthora remorum, and it's, you know, you could call it Phytophthora remorum leaf spot or blight. So California bays get it as a leaf spot, and on the leaves they get these black lesions or leaf spots, and on the surface they make spores. They make clomidal spores, or they'll make sporangia. And those will splash off of the leaves in rain and wind and onto adjacent oaks. So one of the early observations was that anytime you found an infected oak, almost invariably, there was a California bay right next to it. Oaks out on their own without anything around them, and often you see oaks like that on these rolling hills, you'll see these individual oaks, they weren't getting infected with sudden oak death. So the California bay is really the typhoid Mary in this disease. The spores are being produced on the leaves of the oaks, on the California bay, I should say, and then they splash on to the oak, and on the oak, it infects the bark. This is really a bark disease, and so it infects the bark. It might go a millimeter or two into the wood of the tree, but that's the interface between where you find the vascular cambium, and that's what Dr. Gabriellino was talking about. If you kill the vascular cambium on a tree, you kill the tree. It is, but the vascular cambium is between the bark and the wood, and it's a single cell row, a single row of cells or line of cells, and on one side is producing the vascular tissue, the xylem that moves the water. On the other side is producing phloem, which moves the sugars. But if you kill the vascular cambium, and then the tree will no longer be able to produce phloem or xylem, and it will die. And the wood of the tree is really just, think of it as straws, or very tiny, tiny little tubes, and they're connected all the way to the roots. The water enters the roots, comes up in the xylem vessels, and is connected all the way to the leaves. So it's a continuous stream of water. If you get a bubble in there, it stops working. So the old xylem in the middle of the tree is no longer functioning. Almost all the water is being moved in the outer two rings. And Those rings are made because in the spring, the vascular cambium is dividing and growing rapidly and making large cells. And in the summer, it grows slower and makes small cells. In the winter, it stops growing entirely. So you end up with large cells next to very small cells, and that makes a line, and you see rings in a tree. Each ring is 1 year's growth. Well, if you look in at a tree, all the water, about 80% of the water, is moved in the outer two or three rings. In fact, it might even really be 100% of the water is being moved in those outer two, three, four rings. The middle of the tree, the heart of the tree, no longer moves water. And the xylem is not really alive anymore. It's just hollow tubes. The phloem is alive. But the point is that Phytophthora morum infects the bark, gets into about a millimeter or two in the xylem, and actually kills the cambium. So that canker will start out maybe about this big, but then it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And after about 2 or 3 years, it will grow all the way around the tree. You'll have a canker that could be 4 feet long and 3/4 or 80%, maybe more, around the trunk of the tree. That's when the tree is going to die, because now you've killed the entire vascular cambium. You've girdled the tree. So there's not a lot you can do to treat a tree once it's infected. You could try and treat it with chemicals that control Phytophthora. Now, Phytophthora is not a fungus. Historically, it was considered a fungus, but it is really what we know today. It is a parasitic algae. It is closely related to brown algae. And so there are proposals to redo the kingdom system and have a kingdom called Chromista, which would include the diatoms, brown algae, and the oomycetes, and Phytophthora is a member of the oomycetes, the water molds. And so Phytophthora has a sister genus called Pythium, and Phytophthora and Pythium are primarily root rot-causing organisms. Really, all the Phytophthora species, all the Pythium species, are pathogenic on plants. There are some members of the oomycetes that are parasitic on fish, that cause disease on fish. And so almost all the members of the water molds really are pathogens. They've lost their ability to be photosynthetic, and they're living off of some other host. So there are some chemical controls that you can use. If you had an oak tree that had sudden oak death, you could chisel out that canker. Hopefully you get it when it's small. If it's big and huge, it's too late. But if you had a small one, you could chisel that out, and you could treat that with either a product called Subdue, and the active ingredient is called Metalaxyl. It's also sold under the name Ritamil, that's labeled for ag production for vegetable and fruit trees. And Subdue is labeled for ornamentals. The other are the phosphonates, and that includes Aliette, Phosphite, Agrifos, and they're different chemistries. But they both are very effective at controlling Phytophthora. And normally they're used as a root drench. Aliette and the phosphonates can be used as a foliar spray. Well, we've run out of time today. We'll be back next week where we're going to talk about cactus. We've got two more broadcasts this semester. So we'll talk about cactus. We'll talk about aloes and agaves after that. I want to thank the crew for their hard work today, helping to get the show out, and thank everybody who called in. It's a beautiful day out, a good day to work in your garden. So I want to wish everyone happy gardening. Enjoy the rest of your weekend, and we'll see you next week. Take care.